So let's summarize what we've done in Unit 7. I introduced two- and three-dimensional dynamical systems, two- and three-dimensional differential equations, and two-dimensional iterated functions. And the main new thing or object to think about from this unit was the idea of phase space, so a phase plane or a phase space, or in the discrete dynamical system case for the Hannon map, those XY plots. So I started by introducing the Lotka-Volterra equation, and this was the main example of a two-dimensional differential equation. So we have two equations, that's, should be an R for rabbits. But good thing I noticed that. So we've got two differential equations, keeping track of two variables, R and F. And R, the rabbits depend on the rabbits and the foxes depend on the rabbits and the foxes. So we'd say they're coupled. The fates of the rabbits and the foxes are intertwined. So these are known as the Lotka-Volterra equations, and they're in ecology and perhaps in economics as well, sort of the basic model, this most simple model of a predator-prey interaction. So we can solve these differential equations using Euler's method or the like, and we have two solution curves. This is rabbits as a function of time, and these are the foxes as a function of time, and we notice that they oscillate. So we have these two solution curves, and then to try to get a qualitative picture of what's going on and how R and F, rabbits and foxes, are related to each other, we can plot R against F and get rid of time. And that's just the two-dimensional version of the phase lines that we've worked with before. Doing so gives us a picture like this. We plot R and F against each other, and it shows how R and F are related. And in this case, we move this way on the diagram. The rabbit population increases, then the fox population increases while the rabbits decrease, then the foxes decrease, and then the rabbits come back again. So we see how these two cycles are related. So that's the phase plane. It's often useful to show several different solutions on the same phase plane. If there are multiple equilibria, maybe show those. And that's sometimes called a phase portrait. It gives an overall view of the qualitative features of the differential equations. And by qualitative, I mean the long-term fate of orbits. So this would be the phase portrait for the Lotka-Volterra system. And we see that for different starting values of rabbits and foxes, we get different cycles. But in all cases, we have cycles. And these cycles turn out to be neutral, meaning that if you're, meaning that they're neither attracting nor repelling. If you're on this cycle and you move off a little bit, you're just on another cycle. You don't get repelled away or pushed back. Another example that I considered was the van der Waals oscillator, another two-dimensional differential equation. And this is interesting because it has what's called a limit cycle. So the limit cycle itself is this repeating shape here, and we can see that multiple orbits are drawn towards it. So it's an attractor. Here's an orbit from outside that gets pulled into the cycle. Here's one from inside that gets pulled into the cycle. So in two-dimensional differential equations, we can have oscillating solutions, and we can have cycles that are attractors. These are known as limit cycles. So then we talked some about the consequences of determinism in the phase plane. So the dynamical system is deterministic. It's just a rule that tells how R and F, or X and Y, whatever they are, change in time. Another way of saying that is that the initial condition and the differential equation, the rule, specifies a unique path through the phase plane. If I tell you the starting point in the rule, there's one and only one solution to the equation. And as a result of this, curves on the phase plane cannot cross. If they did cross, it would violate determinism. It would mean that from that point, there would be two possible curves, and that violates this notion of determinism. So solution curves on the phase plane cannot cross each other. And that has some important consequences. So the fact that curves cannot cross limits the possible long-term behavior of 2D differential equations. So what can those behaviors be? Well, there can be stable and unstable fixed points, and you could spiral in addition to sort of getting pulled in. So you have a fixed point and you spiral towards it, but still, fixed points, stable and unstable. Orbits could tend to infinity. There can be limit cycles, like in the Van der Waal oscillator, which is a type of attracting cyclic or periodic behavior. And that's pretty much it. And so there's a famous and important result known as the Poincaré-Bendixson theorem, which says, simplifying somewhat, that bounded aperiodic orbits are not possible for two-dimensional differential equations. And of course, that assumes that the right-hand sides of the differential equations aren't crazy and discontinuous or something like that. So the main consequence of this is that we can't see chaotic behavior in two-dimensional differential equations of this sort. We can't see aperiodic bounded orbits. I should mention, by the way, that I've, for these 2D differential equations, I've just been presenting solutions from Euler's method, but there's some very nice analytical techniques for 2D differential equations, but they're beyond the scope of this course. They need calculus and typically a little bit of linear algebra. So in 1D, we can characterize equilibria points by whether or not the curve, the function f of x, the right-hand side of the differential equation, when we're drawing those phase lines, if it crosses the axis like this or like this. And basically what that means is that it depends on the slope. Is the slope positive? Is the slope negative? There's an analog in 2D, but it has to do with the eigenvalues of a 2x2 matrix instead of a simple slope. So anyway, this is in most differential equation textbooks, certainly those that take a modern approach or a dynamical systems approach, which is more and more textbooks these days. So it won't, if you want to know more, it won't be hard to find additional references. Okay, so that was two-dimensional differential equations. Then we looked at two-dimensional iterated functions. So these are like the logistic equation, an iterated function. Time moves and jumps, the population moves and jumps. But now we just have two things we're keeping track of, x and y. So this says that the next value of x is this function of the current value of y and x, and the next value of y, in this case, is a function only of x. This is an example known as an Enon map, commonly studied example. And the story for 2D iterated functions is pretty similar to that of 1D. There can be fixed points, there can be cyclic behavior, and there can be aperiodic behavior, there can be chaos. What's new is that we can plot these x and y points on a 2D grid like I've done here, and that's another way to see the sorts of patterns that the orbits are creating, and we'll spend a bunch of time on that in the next unit. Let's see, so just a little bit more about two-dimensional iterated functions. Mathematically, they're very similar to 1D iterated functions. Orbits can be periodic, and we can also have chaotic behavior. Just a reminder that chaotic behavior is bounded, aperiodic orbits that have sensitive dependence on initial conditions. So lastly, we looked at three-dimensional differential equations. And the example I used was the Lorentz equations. So here are three differential equations. The variables are x, y, and z. This is a very simplified model of atmospheric convection. The sort of physical origins of this model aren't important for what we want to do here. There are three parameters. They're Greek letters, sigma, rho, and beta. So this is a rule for how three things vary in time instead of two. So if we use Euler's method or the like to do to get a solution for this, we'll get three solution curves. X versus time, y versus time, and z versus time. And we can plot those in time. And in this case, we see periodic wiggling in all of these. Then it can be interesting and fun to plot x, y, and z against each other. So this is like a phase plane, but because there's a z now, it's a phase space. It's three-dimensional. So that makes things a lot more interesting. So here's what those periodic solutions look like in phase space. So it's oscillating up and down in the z direction, in sideways in the x, and sideways in the y, and it makes this curly, loopy shape. It looks like these lines cross, but they don't really, because this is three-dimensional space, so this line is above that one. Right? So just like this finger is above that one. It looks like they cross, but they aren't really, because it's a three-dimensional space. Okay. So curves in phase space cannot intersect, just like they can't intersect on a phase plane. But because space is three-dimensional, curves can go over or under each other. And that means that for three-dimensional differential equations, the solution curves can sort of wind around each other and weave around each other without actually crossing. And so we'll see much more complicated behavior in 3D differential equations than in 2D. And in particular, three-dimensional differential equations can be chaotic. And we'll explore chaos in these 3D differential equations and 2D iterated functions in the next unit, and those explorations will mostly be in phase space. So we'll be looking at what things look like in phase space, and we'll be in for some pretty fun surprises. So this brings us to the end of Unit 7. In this unit, we've looked at dynamical systems in 2 and 3 dimensions. In a certain sense, the story is the same as in one dimension. A dynamical system, remember, is just a deterministic rule that describes how a quantity changes in time. For 2 and 3 dimensional systems, we're just keeping track of 2 or 3 quantities instead of 1. The mechanics of finding those solutions is essentially the same no matter how many variables it is that we're trying to keep track of. We just follow the rule. That's what the dynamical system tells us to do. However, visualizing solutions for higher dimensional systems is a little more interesting and fun because, well, 2 and 3 dimensions are a little more interesting and fun than 1 dimension. And in particular, for differential equations, in higher dimensions, we see much more complex and interesting behavior. And that'll be the topic of the next unit, Unit 8, which is on strange attractors. We'll see that they're these incredible structures that combine order and disorder in some really interesting and surprising ways. So we'll see you next week in Unit 8.